Hi, I'm Hamish Black, and welcome to Writing on Games. It was literary theorist Viktor Shklovsky who said that the purpose of art is to impart the sensation of things as they are perceived, and not as they are known. The technique of art is to make objects unfamiliar, to make forms difficult, to increase the difficulty and length of perception, because the process of perception is an aesthetic end in itself and must be prolonged. Art is a way of experiencing the artfulness of an object. The object is not important. Now, it just so happens that over the past couple of weeks, I've been revisiting a game that I feel encapsulates this statement more than perhaps any other video game I have ever played. A game that so aggressively and deliberately defies nearly all norms of game design, narrative, genre, interface, player expectation, and so much more, that its sheer existence is kind of confusing to me. That game is Suda51's Killer7, and it is wild as fuck! Lately I've been trying to release myself from the grasp of reliance on hyperbole, but I seriously struggle to picture a game that is so boldly fucking insane. Not even the Metal Gear Solid series can approach this level of abstract nonsense. We're not just talking about a game with a weird story here, although it certainly is that. On a fundamental, mechanical level, the fact that this game even got made is utterly astounding. Perhaps the most confusing part? It's been an absolute blast the whole way through. I picked this game up back when it was first released on PS2, and found it to be a confusing, utterly flawed mess of a game that intrigued me like no other. This time around, however, with my seemingly masochistic penchant for art that holds its audience in utter contempt, I have loved every second of my time here. The problem, in this case, is that it's so hard to pinpoint exactly why I've been thinking like this. Like I say, everything about this game defies convention. It's not like you can say, the shooting is good, because in many ways it's not. It doesn't offer a vast world to explore. In fact, it's aggressively linear, to the point that it's almost literally on rails. The narrative isn't inherently satisfying or neatly tied up or whatever. This is a game that, after all these years of playing, I still don't fully understand the overarching narrative, or even just the moment-to-moment plot. Seriously, just perceiving what is happening on screen in front of you at any given time can be tricky. Hell, this is a game for which they literally released a separate book explaining what it all meant, and I'm not even kidding, you can read hand in Killer7 online. And even that seemed to raise more questions than it answered. So why is it that this game had such a profound effect on me, both back when I first played it and revisiting it now? To this, I would say that during the time I spent playing it, I came to the realization that it was none of these things, and yet it was all of these things. Everything about the game, when taken and examined on its own, could very easily be described as anywhere from flawed to outright broken. However, I kept finding myself returning to that Shklovsky quote I mentioned at the start, and the essay it is taken from, entitled Art as Technique. The point of that essay was to talk about his thoughts on Verfremdungsgefecht effect, or the distancing effect, consisting of many different kinds of literary techniques, which, when used by authors such as Tolstoy, or later on by playwrights such as Bertolt Brecht, had the effect of breaking the audience's immersion. It shocked them out of their habitual recognition of symbols and patterns by breaking the fourth wall, for example. In his essay, Shklovsky talks about how this recognition becomes habitual, and it's only by shocking the person experiencing a text that an author can break that automation of perception and more deeply impact the reader. It is this context with which I want to analyse just why it is that I adore Killer7 so much. In this episode of Writing on Games, I will mainly be making reference to the Shklovsky piece, which I will link in the description, in order to explain why it's okay that Killer7 is all style and no substance, because it's also all substance as well? It's immersive as hell because it's art, and yet it's art because in Shklovsky's mindset, it is not immersive. I want to try and break down why Killer7's flaws not only fail to detract from an overall sense of enjoyment within the game, but they actually help to contribute to Killer7's impact as a piece of art. Essentially, all of what I'm about to say can be boiled down to the quote I mentioned at the start of the piece. Art is a way of experiencing the artfulness of an object. The object is not important. I want to take each element of the game on its own and examine its flaws, and then argue why it is important that it can be experienced in its flawed state. It's hard to even know where to start with this stuff, because, as I will explain, quite literally everything here defies convention. Let's start at the beginning then. Perhaps the most obvious way in which this game foregrounds its insanity, its narrative. As I say, having played through this game multiple times, even I still don't understand most of what's going on here. Suda himself describes the plot as, "The Smith Alliance, led by Harmon Smith, is a group of assassins hired by the government. Harmon has 7 split personalities at his disposal and utilizes them to complete his assignment as they go up against the Heaven Smiles, the zombie-like creatures the player primarily fights against, unleashed by Kun Lan." The antagonist of the game, I guess? I mean, this all seems like fairly simple video game narrative. Kill the enemies using different characters with different abilities. What this synopsis fails to mention, though, is absolutely everything else happening within the game. The fact that the ghostly apparitions of previous targets appear to you frequently, including a guy that thrusts the air whilst wearing a tank top that says hustle to talk cryptic nonsense about the larger political intrigue that involves world peace, but then also a hypothetical nuclear war between the USA and Japan, but then it's also about a child assassin called Amir who Harmon trained, but then also Harmon and Kun Lan might be gods, but then Harmon might have both a physical and a deity form, and also the Killer7 might be dead or they might not be real, and there's also the harvesting and selling of child organs, and you play as a luchador armed with the grenade launchers, and there's an anime level where you fight superheroes, and according to one of the characters, the secret to hitting on women with 100% success is that they're all the same, and oh my god, I just can't. Believe me when I say that this doesn't even begin to scratch the surface of where Killer7's plot and overarching narrative go. Producer Hiroyuki Kobayashi stated that when you make it to the end, the mysteries of the game will become clear. And I can personally confirm that to be categorically false. None of this shit makes any sense, and it's constantly shifting from skater kid colloquialisms to mind-melting spiritual talk to hypothetical political intrigue that would never happen in the real world to fucking superheroes and anime to the sale of child organs. The tone is all over the place, and this is reflected in the drastic shift between settings. One minute you'll be in a theme park, then you'll enter a door, and suddenly you'll be in a living room watching two guys play chess, and you'll be wandering through a decrepit hotel, only to come across a bunch of burly dudes shooting each other over a game of mahjong. It doesn't follow any kind of coherent continuity, and Kobayashi describes the game as more of a compilation than a start-to-end story. The reason this is strange is because it defies any semblance of Western or Aristotelian dramatic structure that we might be used to. It bombards the viewer as if they were flicking through channels on a TV set, and TVs are an almost ubiquitous aesthetic within the game, and never lets up. It never lets the viewer become comfortable. One can interpret this in many ways. One can say it's a statement on the aggression of American imperialism and the passivity of its citizens sitting in front of the TV. One could say it's about the futility of war and of peace. Or one could say Suda just likes anime a whole bunch. What I would say though is that through this constant bombardment, the narrative of the game becomes not one of geopolitical symbolism, although that is apparent, but rather it becomes a game about the inherent absurdity of playing games. It's a game filled with systems that most developers want to make invisible to the player, but here, the player is confronted with their absurdity and abstraction at every turn. Essentially, it's about getting the players to think. Suda has said that it is his firm belief that video games are the most challenging form of artistic media we know, and this game, at the very least, proves the plausibility of that statement. This is because not only is this estrangement proven through the narrative, but Suda actually weaves this subversion of expectation into the gameplay itself. In order to discuss this, I want to talk about how the game defied my own personal expectations of what it was going to be through its trailers. Early footage featured on old demo discs was what initially got me super excited about this game. Not only was the footage dripping with style, but the editing was so manic that it was hard not to be at the very least intrigued. That said, the footage shows a number of characters running around in a 3D space, occasionally shifting to what looks like incredibly fast first-person shooting. The idea of shifting from third to first-person between exploration and combat respectively was probably the strangest mechanical element one could glean from these trailers alone. It seemed like a game where a bunch of kooky characters shot a whole bunch of zombies. Fairly standard video game fare. Imagine my surprise then, when as a 15-year-old kid taking this game back from the store, that the tutorial reveals the game to be a case of holding down the X button on the PS2, or the A button on the GameCube, to run forward on a fixed path, with circle or B allowing the character to turn 90 degrees and go back the way they came. Not only this, but the speedy, frenetic shooting of hordes of zombies as advertised in the trailer was replaced with one of the strangest yet most fascinating shooting systems I have come across in a game. Essentially, when the player hears the laugh of a heaven smile, they must enter first person mode by hitting a shoulder button, then hitting another shoulder button to use the character's scanning ability to make the enemies visible, and then aiming and sniping at glowing weak spots on the enemies as they slowly trudge towards you. If they get too close, they explode, damaging the character. Now, on the surface, this seems almost inherently absurd. Here we have a game that pushed itself as an action-packed shooter, yet the actual game has movement on rails and slow, fidgety sniping, as opposed to the fast and frenetic shooting shown in the trailers. Recoil, at least at the start, is intense, and your aim will go way off every time you take a shot. As someone who expected something completely different, not only was this jarring, it was unbelievably disappointing. In fact, right up until I began playing it again, I remembered it being sluggish and unwieldy. However, when you view it in the context of distancing or defamiliarization, the art of not only the system, but the bait and switch pulled by Suda51 and Grasshopper Manufacture becomes apparent. It's here that the player must realize that the game utterly defies genre. It pushes itself as a very easily classifiable shooter, perhaps with slight exploration elements. What you realize though is that the game has so many different genres, and at the same time is unbelievably obfuscatory in its willingness to allow the player to define any one of them. In many ways, it would actually be most accurate to call it an adventure game. For all that movement is essentially on rails, there are branching junctions that allow for light exploration of very specific areas, and these often lead to objects required to solve a puzzle. That said, the puzzles often come down to literally exploring another path, finding the object, and unlocking the door. You could call it a shooter, but as I've stated, the shooting is so slow and fidgety that it would struggle to stand up to a more typical action shooter. The game, by not allowing for any direct classification, then forces the player to think outside of the box in terms of what it's actually trying to achieve. And this is where things become interesting. Is it a survival horror game? I guess one could call it that, but the general style of the game is so cartoonish, its levels so bright and stark, that it would struggle to be aesthetically placed alongside the murkier examples of that genre, for example, Resident Evil. Also, unlike those games, you have infinite ammo, and health is merely an enemy's weak spot away. Its jaunty, often pulsing electronic soundtrack, its quirky characters and absurd tone of writing don't serve to send chills down the player's spine, but often to make them laugh at the sheer insanity of everything going on in front of them. In other words, like it's not just an adventure game or just a shooter, it's not just a survival horror game. When you consider though that the puzzle and horror elements extend to the actual mechanics of the shooting in the game, then it becomes more apparent that this game, by meshing all of these genres, is essentially its own totally unique thing. The horror becomes apparent when you are walking down a hallway, and you hear a laugh, something which usually connotes joy, being used to strike fear into the player. The smiles have a jaunty step to their movements, letting out little laughs during each step, as well as when they get shot. And when they get close enough to the player, their death cry is one of hysterics. This is too easy. The puzzle elements make their way into this as well. Essentially, when one enters first person mode, the screen they see is a puzzle to be solved. It's a puzzle of priorities. The tension arises when the player realizes that despite the aesthetically slow and sluggish aiming speed and massive amounts of recoil forcing them to recalibrate after every shot, the enemies are constantly moving towards you. Through this constant sense of enemy momentum, the player must decipher quickly the abilities and speed of the character they have selected, the amount of enemies on screen, the types of enemies on screen, that is to say different enemies require different methods of shooting, the relative threat of each enemy type, and the location of each weak spot. Once the player has figured all of this out and constructed the plan of how the combat puzzle will play out in their head, the player is then forced to execute. This is essentially the second part of the puzzle. One misplaced shot or unexpected reload animation can result in the player's plan changing completely, with certain enemies moving in front of one another, for example. This forces the player to think on their feet, as the solution to this abstract puzzle has now changed completely and can result in death. The important part about all of this is that techniques designed to defamiliarize the player are weaved into almost every element of the game's mechanics and design. As I say, taken individually, these seemingly disparate mechanics, genres, and design choices can easily be construed as a mess. The movement is restrictive, the transition between movement and shooting is jarring, the shooting mechanics are sluggish, the typical puzzles are overly simple, the horror genre doesn't seem to match up with the bright, humorous tone of the environments and writing. I could go on. I mean, we have standards of genre, mechanics, control methods, etc. for a reason, right? There is a reason first-person shooters allow freedom of movement and have snappy aiming, or on a basic level, use left trigger to aim and right trigger to shoot, right? There's a reason survival horror games evoke a certain atmosphere or implement ammo and health constraints, right? These things just work, right? Well, yes, they work. But to make reference to Sklovsky's argument once again, when things merely work, they become habitual, automated. In Sklovsky's view of art, once objects become this habitual, they become purely functional, and therefore have no impact on the person perceiving it. He likens this to the process of using symbols in algebra, and makes reference to Alexander Pagodin's argument of a boy considering a sentence merely by each word's first letter. When objects reach this level of innate perception, we can automatically perceive it through a simplistic symbol, and in Sklovsky's view, this deadens art. It renders an object purely functional, and renders the artful unartful. This is why people tire so much of annualized franchises. No one can argue that their mechanics are not unbelievably sound and that they are unquestionably well put together games, yet this level of efficiency in mechanics and design can often leave the games feeling like plastic, like all the edges have been sanded down. We expect those games to work, we expect them to release annually, we expect everything that these games have to offer. The automatic release cycle begets automatic design. When one examines Killer7, on the other hand, one finds a number of design choices that seemingly hold the player back from the most efficient path forward. But this does not inherently make them bad design choices. The game is designed on every level to jolt the player out of their comfort zone, and Suda51 and the team at Grasshopper Manufacture are not afraid to confront the player with things that might be considered flaws in other games, if it makes the player actively think about what it is they are experiencing. Whether this is distancing for the sake of distancing doesn't actually matter all that much. Like I say, I still don't have a firm grasp on most of the events taking place in the game. This is game design as art for art's sake, and when every design choice is so carefully woven together through their individual flaws, it makes the game inherently challenging, interesting, and impactful. This isn't player-driven narrative. This is a game seemingly about nothing at all, and as such, it makes a statement about the player directly to the player. That is, if they're willing to work to figure that out. I could honestly gush about this game for hours, but I'll stop here. This game absolutely is not for everyone, but if what I have talked about here seems interesting to you in some way and you have access to a GameCube or PS2, or you're able to emulate the game on PC, then I absolutely implore you to check it out. It's legitimately like nothing else I have ever played, and it deserves a wider audience for its sheer audacity. Also, I just want to take the opportunity to thank my patrons for their generous support, including Nico, Artyom, Christian, Jeff, Gareth, Jess, Matthew, Adam, Gary, Gerald, Joe, Luca, Morgan, Dylan, Robert, Jonas, and Bruno. It means the absolute world to me, and we are so close to hitting the next goal of a podcast, which will be fun, I hope. Thank you so, so much, and if you feel like supporting the show, then if you'd consider pledging, then I'd be forever thankful. And with all of that said, I'm Hamish Black, and this has been Writing on Games. Thank you very much for watching, and I'll see you next time.